First of all, Marcos, I would like to know what's the real status of 5G globally, and what do you expect for 5G in countries like Brazil?
Yeah, 5G has accelerated quite a bit recently. Verizon recently announced that they would be deploying 5G in 2017. And here we are in late 2015. So within 2 years, you'll see 5G networks being built. The Koreans had already said that they would build 5G in 2018 for the Winter Olympics. So I think you're going to see 5G within a couple of years. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, you're going to see a number of things. One is new spectrum being used, probably. Even though it won't have been standardized yet, spectrum in the millimeter wave bands, which are very high frequency, and so they don't go very far. They fade with distance very, very badly. So they go about 50 meters, 100 meters. So you're going to see a network built of small cells that are only 100 meters away from you. And those networks are going to be outdoor and indoors. But because of that use of high frequency, we will get bandwidth that could be a gigabit per user on wireless. Imagine that. We've just done a gigabit on G.fast per user on a wire, and we might be, in the next few years, approaching a gigabit on wireless. So you really see that the equivalence of wireline and wireless. I like to say some parts of 5G are about beamforming. And if you think about it, beamforming is just creating an air wire. Right? You're trying to get all the energy down a little path that looks like a wire. So we're going to make the air and the wire look equivalent and have gigabits per second per user, which is, of course, interesting, not just for developed nations, but in developing countries. It means that wherever you didn't have copper, you could actually perhaps start having really ultra-broadband services. But at the same time, we're going to enable machines. And machines typically have a lower bandwidth requirement, but they have very high scale and control. Because there are so many machines, you need lots of control capabilities. So we might have 100 times more control capacity. And because of that, we're going to run that control plane in the cloud. And that is very interesting because it allows us to say the future is about running control planes in clouds, and those clouds are going to be very close to you. So you're going to have very high capacity small cells very close to you. You're going to have clouds running the control plane very close to you. So in some ways, it's the beginning of the new local. Not just local at the national level, but even local within, say, 10, 20, 30 kilometers of you. So networks are going to get hyper-local again, which is very interesting in the context of Brazil, I think. Because suddenly, what perhaps was being offshored or was being centralized now has a local context again. And with that local context, I will provide analytics, some behavior. I will know what you want when you want it. I will secure it locally. So it's a brand new way of networking by going hyper-local.
And when you said about 5G, in your presentation, you mentioned that the local is the new global.
Yes.
What exactly do you mean about this?
What I mean is, if you think about where the value has gone in the last few years, it's gone to the global web scale players, to the Googles, the Facebooks, the Twitters, you could argue, Amazon. But we're going to see a shift back where the value is going to be at the local level because the cloud is going to go local to provide very high capacity, low latency interactive services where you're running part of your device in the cloud, you're running, you know, gaming services and controlling very latency-sensitive things. Think about flying a drone, controlling a car. Those are very low latency things. You have to be almost, you know, a touch distance away, or the way we say it, a human response distance. And it turns out human response distance is not very far. So in that case, the global providers will actually be using local facilities, and those local facilities will actually be owned by telcos and others like telcos. So they end up getting more power in the relationship. If you think the relationship is dysfunctional because there's a lot of power in the global and the power in local has been lost. It's commoditized, it's essentially a dumb pipe model. But I think as we build these local clouds, the balance reappears because it's all part of the same global local cloud, service delivered locally, imagined globally. And that's sort of a better coupling. I like to say, instead of being a competition, it's a collaboration. They both need each other. So I think we're moving from a model where it's over the top to actually in the network. You know, it's in the top, or there's no top anymore. It's really together working in harmony to create a new reality of global services delivered locally.
Do you think the companies over the top and they fight for the operators, for the market? Because now in Brazil, the operators doesn't like the OTTs. Why OTTs is so important in this moment in the telecommunications market?
OTTs are very creative. If you think about it, they have completely changed business models. They've invented social. They've invented the search for information. They've invented ways to, you know, change the taxi industry, ways to change the hotel industry. They're very creative in business model innovation. And so what they're great at is creating what I like to call digital goods value platforms or digital goods exchange platforms that exchange value. They allow you to find things and exchange value, rent, you know, get a car to come to you within 5 minutes, find an apartment. They're extremely good at business model innovation, leveraging global cloud infrastructure. But what they need going forward is a lot of contextual information, and they need to deliver services locally. And so you see increasingly the global web companies are looking to have local facilities or be hosted locally so that they can do even more contextual delivery, lower latency, higher performance. Think of it as Netflix. Netflix is becoming a global video provider, but in the end, it needs to be delivered locally with very high performance, high quality. So those are the types of things. Think of drone flying. You could have a global drone company, but in the end, the control of that drone is local. The information coming from that drone is processed locally. So I think there's a very interesting new reality where the business model creativity of the web scale players and the physical layer creativity and of the telcos come together to be a happy alliance, not a competition.
And finally, in the future and in the present, the software is the new king of the network.
Yeah, of course, one of the ways we're going to manage this is we're creating software versions of networks. It's called software-defined networking. What it means is you take the software piece of the network out of the box and put it in the cloud. And which cloud? That local cloud, because it turns out it's very important to keep that piece of software close to the actual physical function. So you're going to run the network software in a local cloud, and that will allow you to scale instead of just at the scale of people. And as we know, there are only 6 billion people in the world. But what if I want to scale to 100 machines for every person, 100 instruments, 100 sensors? I need a trillion things. So I need to build a network that can scale to a trillion in the control plane. And that's what I'll do by taking the software out of the hardware, running it in an edge cloud, and then I can scale it dynamically. When a lot of people are clustered in an area for an event, a sporting event, the Olympics, or the World Cup, I can scale my control plane. When they leave, I bring it back down. So it's sort of the way that I can get infinite scaling of my network using cloud techniques. And it's the same cloud on which I'm going to host these new services. So it's a very interesting connection of architecture and business models and technology. It's all coming together, which is why I really believe it's going to be a new alliance between OTTs and telcos as opposed to competition.